She would later reflect, "Bob was like a father to me. I owe so much to him for being there for me at that time." As a civil rights activist, Dr. Coles was deeply immersed in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC, marched with Dr. King, and worked with Robert Kennedy. Since that time, Dr. Coles has consistently used the power of his teaching and his pen to give voice to the oppressed and remind each of us of the shared responsibility we have to address the injustices in our community, whether they affect us directly or not. We are so honored to have Dr. Coles and his family with us here tonight. Can we please give him one more round of applause? We are also thrilled to have an amazing group of people here with us tonight to help honor Alicia Garza. First of all, we have Denasia Yancey, Lanise Frazier, and Martin Henson from Black Lives Matter Boston, who have been instrumental in this movement in Massachusetts and across the country.
My name is Denasia. I'm the founder and lead organizer of Black Lives Matter Boston. And Martin and Lanise are a couple of our lead organizers as well. So thanks for having us. So we're here to introduce and honor Alicia Garza, one of the co-founders of Black Lives Matter Network. Alicia is being honored for her social justice work in many roles, currently as the Special Projects Director for the National Domestic Workers Alliance. However, I want to focus on Alicia as a person and a little bit deeper. So she describes herself as an organizer, a writer, and a freedom dreamer, which I think is really, really awesome. Alicia started Black Lives Matter as a love note to Black folks in 2013 after the acquittal of George Zimmerman. And I think that love note that was on social media that told other Black people that their lives matter shows the power of words and the power of turning words into visions for a new world. Black Lives Matter serves as both an affirmation for Black folks of our own humanity and a call to action for everyone to bring to reality the vision of a world where Black lives truly do matter. Myself and my team are grateful and honored for Alicia's leadership, for a politic that says that all Black lives matter, that lifts and loves our queer and transgender family, our undocumented family, our young people, folks who have traditionally been welcome to offer their blood, sweat, and tears to movements, but not their experiences, their ideas, and their unique concerns. So we are so proud to be part of a movement that leaves that leaves none of our people behind, and that honors the freedom dreamer in each of us. Thank you.
So I always start every discussion with the mission of Harvard College. So the mission of Harvard College has been for almost four centuries now to educate the citizens and citizen leaders for our society. It's a mission that the college takes quite seriously. We helped educate some of the people who imagined this country and its aspirations. Our alumni, our faculty, our students, were some of the key people involved in the anti-slavery and abolition movements in the 18th century. Other than the two oldest military academies, no institution has given more lives and services to this nation than Harvard College, which is memorialized by the walls here. And other than that, the two oldest military academies, no institution has more people awarded the Medal of Honor than the college. And this notion of citizenship and citizen service runs through so many different areas, as we just heard with Dr. Coles' brief background. Civil rights movement, women's rights, equality of marriage. Everywhere there is injustice, complex problems, you will see often people who are members of this community trying to make the world a better place. And like our own society, our aspirations run ahead of our reality. But we do this through our belief in the transformative power of liberal arts and sciences education. And it begins for us with the intellectual transformation. New ways of knowing, new ways of understanding, all toward the goal of developing an independent mind. And then embedding that in a very diverse living experience where our students study alongside students who are different from them, who have different walks of life, have different identities, evolving identities, which we believe not only deepens the intellectual transformation, but creates the conditions for a social transformation. Their understanding of what it means to be part of a community. That a community is not just simply a collection of interests, and that dialogue is not simply the exchange of claims and counterclaims. And then we hope through those experiences our students begin to answer some questions for themselves. Who am I and who do I want to be? How do I relate to others and what can I learn from others? What are my gifts and talents and how can I best use them to serve the world? So a personal transformation. And as you've heard, the Robert Coles Call of Service Award was established in 2007 to recognize those individuals who are at the forefront of advancing goals like these, in particular, social justice in our nation, as it's embodied in Dr. Cole's teaching and the Phillips Brooks House mission. Today, we recognize those ideals and values with our recipient, Alicia Garza. Ms. Garza, you have opened dialogue on some of the most important issues of our times, addressing the inequities of our society. Your actions, your words, your vision has opened a larger conversation in our nation about who we are as a people and what we want our collective and shared future to be like. You're encouraging all of us to test the espoused values of our society against the everyday lived realities of millions. You have helped in usher a new awareness about the urgency to create a new civic philosophy that will move us toward becoming a more compassionate and humane society. On behalf of Phillip Brooks House, please come forward to receive the 2015 Robert Coles Call of Service Award.
thank so deeply the Phillips Brooks House Association. It's a mouthful. Pbha in the house. Thank you so much for being incredible hosts and also for such a long legacy of deep and true service to the communities who make this area what it is. I also want to give a big thank you to Robert Coles. It was wonderful to meet you. I'm honored to receive this award that is in your name. And I'm honored to be sharing space with you. I also want to thank and love on and dedicate this award to the BLM network, to folks like Denisia and Denise, and all the folks who are really exemplifying the world that we want to live in, and not waiting for that to come, but living it right here and right now, daring to live it right here, right now, unapologetically. Thank you for your work. And I also want to dedicate this award more broadly, beyond the BLM network, because we are just one component of a broader movement. This award is certainly deserved by young people who did not go home in Ferguson, Missouri, after Mike Brown was killed. Young people who have still not gone home, and it's been more than a year now. And even though the news cameras and the news stations have in some ways stopped talking about Ferguson, except to call it an effect, we will not, we shall not, and we must not forget that people are still fighting for their humanity, for their dignity in Ferguson, Missouri. People are still fighting for their dignity and humanity in Baltimore, in Cleveland, where the person who murdered a 12-year-old child was cleared of all charges. And that child's mother, Tamir Rice's mother, still grieving, still waiting for justice. In a few weeks, many of us will sit around a table with our families, share a lot of food, laugh together. But as we do that, we should have a moment of silence. In my tradition, we take some of the food that we're about to eat, the nourishment that we are about to receive, and we set it aside for the ancestors who walk alongside of us. But we should also set that food aside for the ancestors who became ancestors way too soon. Why is a 12-year-old child an ancestor? And so in the spirit of this award, I do think it's appropriate to call some names and bring those folks into the room, because certainly I'm humbled and I'm honored to receive this award. But we have to remember it's not about me. It's about we. And so I want to lift up some of the names that bring us here, that bring me here today. Otis Byrd, who was hung in Mississippi. Martez Harvey. Tanisha Anderson. Yvette Smith. Miriam Carey. Shelley Fry. Darnisha Harris. Melissa Williams. Alicia Thomas. Chantel Davis. Rakia Boyd, Ayanna Stanley Jones, she was 7, Tarika Wilson, Katherine Johnston, she was 92, Alberta Spruill, Kendra James, Lamia Beard, Ty Underwood, Michelle Payne, Maya Hall, Jesse Hernandez, Taja Gabriel de Jesus, Penny Proud, Oscar Grant, Michael Brown, Renisha McBride, Sandra Bland. The list goes on and on and on and on, and I can't even keep all the names in this phone. And so we dedicate this award, this Call of Service Award, to those who have activated many of us to serve. And we dedicate this award to their families who became celebrities when they did not want to. When we started Black Lives Matter, it was indeed written as a love note. It was written as a love note on a social media platform known as Facebook. In a moment of intense, profound rage and grief. When George Zimmerman was acquitted of all charges in killing a child. There we go again. When George Zimmerman was acquitted in the murder of a child, some people call it a tragedy, I call it murder. We should just tell it for what it is. When George Zimmerman was acquitted, I was sitting with friends. And I had been sitting in the same place for several hours because I had been following the trial, not of Trayvon Martin, but of George Zimmerman. And my friends and I were wondering, speculating even, on what would happen. We heard that the jury had reached a verdict, that the verdict would be announced. And so my friends and I sat around talking about what we thought would happen, reviewing the previous few months of a trial that we had watched religiously, no pun intended. And during that trial, we watched as a child was put on trial for their own murder. We watched as that child was demonized, as his parents and their parenting skills were questioned. We watched as the last person to talk to Trayvon was demonized, ridiculed. And though we sat through those months of ridicule and demonization, we thought, for sure, someone will be held accountable for the murder of a child. It was really that basic for us. We didn't question whether or not Trayvon was a thug. We don't think about our people that way. We didn't question what Trayvon must have done to cause his own death because he was just walking home on a cell phone with Skittles and an iced tea. And he happened to encounter someone who took it upon themselves to patrol a community that Trayvon was very much a part of, but not according to George Zimmerman. And so, when the verdict was announced that George Zimmerman would go home to his family, many of us, myself included, were in a state of shock. Because even though we live Black in America the best that we can, even though we understand very deeply what it means to have to protect yourself at every single moment. What it means to have to hide yourself so you're not scary to someone else. What it means to have to collect your dignity up off the floor when someone grabs their purse or crosses the street when you come by, asks you if you know where you are, asks you if you need any help finding something. We know that feeling very well. And even though we know that feeling very well, we thought, it's 2013. How could someone get away with the murder of a child? When the verdict was announced, I didn't have anything to say. I sat in a very crowded place with friends who I had known for years, and we sat in silence. In fact, it felt like the entire city went silent that night. And I looked around and I saw people, heads down, eyes averted. Black people who I so desperately wanted to connect with and say, we're going to be okay. We couldn't look at each other. And so in an attempt to make sense of what will never, ever, ever make sense, I went on Facebook to try to see if somebody else could give a word to help me give some words, because I didn't have any. And what I saw was even more disturbing. I saw people like me who are organizers, activists, revolutionaries, saying things like, we already know this is what happens to us. Why are we surprised? Why are we so upset now? This is happening all the time. I get that. But is that what you would say to Sabrina and Tracy as they mourn the loss of their child? And then on the other hand, what we kept hearing was, well, this is a terrible tragedy. So that's why our children need to pull their pants up. That's why our children need to make sure and vote. That's why we have to make sure to get a good education. That's why we have to make sure to not wear hoodies. As if anything that you're wearing or doing, meaning, whether you vote or not, whether you have a GED or a PhD or no degree, if you're black in this country, it doesn't matter. And that's exactly what that verdict said that evening, was that not just that Trayvon's life didn't matter, but it was essentially saying to black people all over this country that our lives don't matter. And so in the grief, in the rage, in the disbelief, it felt necessary to make an intervention to say that our lives do matter, to celebrate the resistance that is blackness, to conjure love, deep, abiding, non-conditional love for one another. We are the soul of this country. We have been the soul of this country.
over and over and over again. So I appreciate Denisha's introduction. Because Black Lives Matter really is a love of our people. It is the defense of our rights to our humanity. And it is a celebration of all of the ways in which we humanize ourselves and the rest of this country every single day. Black Lives Matter is an acknowledgement that Black people are a solution and not a problem to be fixed. It's an acknowledgement that anti-Blackness, the disease of anti-Blackness, has assaulted our own people for so long that we too internalize the notion that something is wrong with us more than is wrong with the system of white supremacy. It is a call to action. It is a call to fight for our people. And when we say Black Lives Matter, we don't exclude any of us. When we acknowledge the dignity, the humanity of the Black lives, we also acknowledge that everyone else's life matters too. You know, it's interesting. Because somehow we've twisted this narrative of Black Lives Matter into a what about me? What would this country be without my people? My sister Heather McGee reminded us that Black lives were the first currency of this nation. Black people, the conditionality of our humanity is written into our Constitution. Our labor shapes this economy. It shapes our business system. Shapes our education system, shapes every system that we live under. We are fighting for our rights to live in a world of transformative humanity. Meaning, if we're able to rid this world of anti-Blackness, everybody benefits. So the question of what about me? Black people are free, truly free. Everyone has the opportunity to be free. Now we're up against a moment. There's 1 million Black people behind bars living in cages today. 1 million out of a total population of 2.5, that means that we're about half. 1 of 21 trans women of color, mostly Black, have been killed just since the beginning of this year. And those are only the trans women who are acknowledged as women. And only the ones who are reported. Black women are the fastest growing population in prisons and jails. In fact, we are 30% more likely to be incarcerated than white women. Why? Well, mostly for what they call crimes of survival. Defending yourself against intimate partner violence. Sometimes getting caught up in a money-making effort with an intimate partner.
Black women have the highest infection rate for HIV and AIDS amongst all women. Every 28 hours in this country, according to the Malcolm X grassroots movement, a black person is killed by vigilantes, security guards, or police. We're up against the bullets. But in the spirit of this conversation, I don't just want to rest and say all of the barriers that were against. Because it is an honor, a real honor, to be alive in this moment. And to even have this much, just this much, to do with what will serve me. Because if that's what we are up against, what we are up to is the business of resistance. Not just fighting back to fight back, but fighting to build something new. We don't just want to take away. We don't just want to invert the pyramid. I heard someone say one time, Black Lives Matter is a supremacist movement. I had to laugh at that one. Our vision is not to have black people on top and everybody else on the bottom. We want to create a new way of being. We don't think we have to have that. We want to transform a society that is parasitic and replace it with one that is regenerative, one that is resilient, one that allows us to live complex lives and celebrates our complexity rather than punishes our rather than punishes our audacity to be every piece of who we are. When I say what we are up to is resistance, what I mean is, at least for the network, that in 1 year we have grown 29 chapters of black people and our allies organizing around anything you could think of. Police brutality, police violence, poverty, unemployment, disenfranchisement, gender-based violence, access to healthcare, a social wage, fighting gentrification, displacement. As our friends at the Black Youth Project 100 say, we are unapologetically black. And we are creating new space to make the impossible possible. What we mean by that is, because of our efforts and many, many, many others, there have been 40 new laws passed in 28 states relating to criminal justice. Because of our efforts and that of many, 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 many others, we are growing a new bench of leaders who are changing the very landscape of this country. That's nothing to sneeze at. My mom said to me the other day, I never thought that I would see another moment like this in my lifetime. never thought I would see another moment like this in my lifetime. What I imagine that means for her is that there was a time, not too long ago, when people believed that something else was possible, felt that it was right around the corner, and if we could just get there, if we could just grab it, if we could just touch it. That we might be able to alter the future. I don't think it's around the corner, but I do believe. And I believe because of the incredible fighters that I get to work with every single day. Now, I don't have a lot of time left. So I want to spend my last moments with a few words about service. I wanted to talk to you all about the work I'm doing with the Domestic Workers Alliance, and we'll do that, person to person. But I will say, we're building a multiracial movement that is fighting the legacy of anti-Black racism. I'm so proud of our team. Women who are courageous enough to say, we got this. We're not waiting for you to do anything. That's how we have poor women, Black women, Latinas, Filipinos, so many women winning, creating our own laws, passing them. 5 statewide bills in 5 states in 5 years. Why? Because we will no longer wait. I wanted to tell you all about how domestic workers and agricultural workers ended up getting the short end of the stick when it came to labor protections. How it wasn't on accident. How Black workers were excluded so that other workers could thrive. And how those workers are still working in the shadows today. One of our leaders told me a story about how she came here from Brazil. She was told that if she came and worked for a family here, that they would pay for her to go to school. And how when she got here, they made her sleep on the porch with an alarm clock. That wasn't that long ago. But instead, I'm going to wrap up with some words about service. So I had an opportunity to have a beautiful dinner with some really powerful leaders. And I was reflecting after we left about the spirit of this award, at least how I understand it. You know, the call to serve is more necessary now than it's been in a long time. Service, as I see it, is about meeting immediate needs, but it's also very, very much about creating our own legacy. Even more than that, it's about the will to stay connected to our very humanity. What it means to acknowledge that there is a purpose bigger than ourselves.
that we are not the center of the universe. That in order to live in a just society, we have to contribute to it. Now, unfortunately, we live in a context where the individual is privileged. Get yours before anybody else gets theirs. It's a race. You know, in our conversation over lunch, we were having this conversation about what do we do when we leave here? How do I stay active? How do I continue to serve? And can I serve and still eat? And maybe once I get there, once I take care of myself, once I succeed, then I can help others. I want to help others. And my sister I was talking to, I was like, yes. We had a great dialogue about what it means to serve. And can we redefine service not as being selfless, but being the truest form of ourself? We talked about priorities. And we talked about how there's many different ways to serve. Service is not just being in the street with picket signs, shutting things down, although that is a service. But service is about prioritizing at every moment the desire for us to free ourselves of the chains that keep us from being our fullest selves. Service is about interdependence. See, we live in a world that is certainly interdependent, but of the parasitic variety. Most of the world depends on the United States and Europe to survive. That is interdependent, certainly, but it is not regenerative. We want to fight for that kind of interdependence that allows us to create new ways of being. I was thinking to myself after this conversation that today the call for service can be perverted. I know when I was in high school, I was required to serve. I had to serve to graduate. And then, of course, there was all of this impetus, right, to pad your resume. Well, if you're going to serve, serve somewhere where it can get you prestige, aspiration, a career, more money, status. But what if we returned to the call of service as our basic duty? What some would say is our rent to live on this planet. What if the call to service was rooted in a deep and fundamental belief that we can live a different world in our lifetime? What would be different about the world that we live in now? What if the call to service said that any profession that I'm in, anything that I'm doing, will be geared towards making sure that my children and my children's children inherit a different world? What if the call to service? Fundamentally disrupted the notion of individualism over the collective. I believe that this award is in that spirit, the spirit of serving more than just ourselves. Serving because we want to be the fullest form of ourselves. Serving because we believe that we will win. I believe that we will win. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
An organizer, a writer, a freedom dreamer. Please join me in thanking Alicia Garza for her incredibly inspiring remarks tonight. My name is Chris Loney. I have the honor of serving as the Phillips Brooks House Association's Alumni Vice President.
My name is Yasmin Asari. I'm a senior at Harvard College, and I serve as the Pbha Alumni and History Coordinator.
So Ms. Garza would like to answer a couple of your guys' questions. And we have time for two to three of those questions, and we have some microphone. We have a microphone here in the middle. So if you have one, come up to the microphone, and we'll get through two to three of them.
While the people with questions are coming forward, I would like to take a moment to thank our hosts at the Memorial Church and Harvard Events Office for their support. I would also like to highlight the rest of the Alumni Weekend and Call of Service Week events outlined in your program. Tomorrow at the Alumni Luncheon, we will be honoring Steve Hawkins, Executive Director of Amnesty International, as this year's outstanding alumnus. Please also join us next Friday, November 6th, as we celebrate the opening of the Y2Y Youth Homeless Shelter with special guest, Senator Elizabeth Warren. We're also honored that following the questions, we will have a performance from Kumba as we head out tonight. Thank you again, everyone, and we can take the first question.
Hi, my name's Evan, and I know I'm only gonna be up here once, so it's kind of a two-parter. Oh yeah, and I'm from Teen Empowerment. So the first part of my question is, we've been working with the police and trying to get some like peaceful coordination between the police and the youth. And I wanted to solicit your advice on how we could do that. I know there's a lot of legislation that would need to be put in place for in order for it to become better. But like on the ground level, what would you, you know, say on that?
Is that your full question?
And then the second part is, you said you want everyone to get involved and everyone to serve. So I was wondering how youth and like organizations like us could get more involved in things of this nature.
Those are great questions. Thank you. So here's the thing. It sounds like what you're doing is really amazing. I'm curious, how's it going?
It's going all right. I'd give it like a solid like 6.
We haven't even started yet.
Okay.
Well, I mean, we've had dialogues, but they haven't been like as, like we've had small dialogues. We've had, you know, I would say like 5 dialogues so far, 2 in the police station, but we're not really getting the officers that like patrol, like the officers we need to see, so.
Yeah, that's a serious thing. So I think that it's important as you are negotiating with your local police department to figure out who your allies are so that you can be taken seriously. You deserve to be meeting with the person who controls policy inside of that department, the person or peoples. And that I would suggest that you may not have to move legislation externally. There's lots of policies inside of that department that can be enacted with someone or someone's giving it the thumbs up. So, it seems like part of what you are having to overcome is the really pervasive anti-youth narrative. And you all are so brilliant because you're like advocating on behalf of yourselves, for yourselves, and I think that's dope and deserves to be respected. And I would ask people in this room to support you. And then what was the second part of your question?
How could organizations like us get more involved?
Well, you're doing it. You're doing it. And here's what I mean by that. I think what's the most important is developing the tools that you need to be active wherever you are. I think all people should learn how to organize, even if you don't become an organizer. Yeah? So there's something in what you're doing that's really powerful. And to me, the question is both, how do you keep deepening your toolbox? And then also, how do you keep replicating new leaders? If you pay attention to that, you're on the right track. Hey.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
Hey, good. How are you?
I'm good.
Good.
I'm Eddie from Teen Empowerment. I go to Balfour.
Yay!
All right.
Y'all both
My question was, because you was talking a lot about, you know, females and how they service. I wanted to know if you have a message for like black men like me into serving.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure, any question you want.
What about what I said was not applicable to you?
It wasn't applicable. It's just that I felt like you came more off of like a feminine side, and I didn't really hear a message like for men. You know what I mean?
If a man gave the speech I just gave, would it have felt like it was more for you?
I'm not saying that either.
No, I'm asking as an honest, legitimate. Oh, I'm not trying to be shady. I'm just asking.
It would have been the same thing. It would have been still powerful. It's just I would like to, you know, like I didn't get most of like what black men are supposed to do. I only heard about what females should do and how much females go through. I didn't really hear about men.
Is anybody taping? Did anybody tape this conversation? Cool. So two pieces. One, I would watch it again.
All right.
Because I was talking to everybody.
All right.
And two, I would really encourage you to think about, what does masculinity mean to you? How does it, I'm not asking you to answer now, but I'm asking you to think about it. And I'm asking you to think about how it serves you and how it doesn't, and what kind of masculinity you think could serve your community in a way that would be powerful and transformative. Did you want to ask another question? Did you want to ask another question?
No, thank you.
Hello.
Before you start, I'm sorry. Let me say something about this, because I think this is important. You know, we hear this a lot. It's like, okay, well, you're empowering the sisters, but what about the young men? And I just really want to challenge that. What I'm saying, and what I just think I did, is there is a bigger world. We live under a lot of different systems. One of those systems is what we lovingly call heteropatriarchy. And in real simple terms, right, it is the centering and the privileging of straight men's experiences over others. Now, what I just spoke to was certainly from my heart, but it wasn't necessarily speaking directly to just women. And I would encourage you to read my brother who just did Fruitvale Station, his piece on why he transformed his language from females to women. But I want to say this because I think it's important. We're talking about transforming power and power relationships. And I think what's complicated for many of us is that we're like, well, I'm black, I don't have power. Right? But we all occupy positions of power. And we all occupy positions where we're dispossessed. It's important to acknowledge that. Now, what I'm encouraging is, I don't think that we need static notions of masculinity. You may have wanted me to say, protect the women, protect the household. I'm not saying you did, I'm saying you may have, right? But I'm not gonna give that message. What I would ask from you and from the cis men in the room is to be thinking about, how does patriarchy impact you? What does masculinity mean to you? What does masculinity mean to a movement? How can it serve a movement? But also, how can it hinder a movement? These are serious questions. Now, I would venture to say that if I was a man saying this, it might be received differently. I only know that from having to deal with this for 34 years. I could be wrong, but what I'm advocating for is, how do we transform the role of masculinity? I don't think masculinity has to be oppressive. I don't think masculinity has to be denigrating. I don't think that black men, cisgendered men in particular, need to take a back seat. I actually don't believe that. I feel like we need to be fighting side by side. But if we're gonna do that, we have to be really honest about the things that hold us back from being able to do that. So that's the question that I'm asking you to consider. Hi.
Hello, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Fine.
Good.
I have a two-part question.
Okey-dokes.
That's fine. So I was wondering first, how can we as a people genuinely expect the government to fairly govern us when it isn't a society that was originally intended for the betterment and the justice for us? Uh-huh. And then my second question is, although I'm like in no way justifying the cruel acts of violence that minorities and particularly black people face in communities, but how do we as advocates, as people who understand this systematic construction that is used to kind of keep certain communities down, how can we talk to these people and kind of empower them and show them, hey, although it's not necessarily right, but maybe you should pull up your pants so you're not judged as a suspect, or maybe don't act a certain way in these certain contexts, or, you know, don't hang out in this corner at this specific time, because although it's not fair that these actions are, you know, making you a target, you're born with this kind of target, and how can we kind of make people acknowledge that and then act upon it? Sorry, it's not, I didn't really word it the way I wanted to, but I hope it's kind of clear.
Okay, thanks for your question. I don't think there's anything wrong with black people. Which doesn't mean that I don't think that there needs to be accountability when harm is caused. But I struggle with this thing around, like, let's tweak some stuff about black people so that we can get farther. It just, to me, it lacks an analysis of power, and it lacks a social and political and historical context. So you can't tell people not to hang out on a corner if they don't have anywhere else to go. You just can't, right? I don't really care how people dress. I just don't. And I don't think that how you're dressed is an excuse to be mistreated. So I struggle with that. And I think what I think you're getting to, I think you're asking, is about how do we transform our relationships, you know? And what I'm hearing underneath your question is like, well, there are problems in our communities. How do we fix them? And what I think we do is we fight to change power relationships. And what I mean by that is we fight to make sure that our communities are invested in. We fight to make sure that people have access to what they need. We fight to make sure that there isn't intimate partner violence in our communities and that we're not throwing people away, but that we're engaging in processes that keep everybody whole. Right? Because part of the thing that I keep seeing is like we want to replicate dynamics that don't work for us. How do we tell people not to kill? How do we tell our people not to kill each other when people are killing us all the time? It's like the logic doesn't make sense. And so what we're ultimately end up asking people to do is have a moral conviction that they're not seeing reflected anywhere else, particularly in the people that are supposed to be protecting them. It's like when, you know, my mom used to say, do what I say, not what I do. And so I would do what she did, right? So I think the way that we transform our communities is by empowering our communities to reshape ourselves on our own terms. Your question about how do we depend on the state when the state doesn't protect us, I don't think that we depend on the state. I still think it's right and fair to demand that the state do what it's supposed to be doing, but I don't think that we hold our breath for that. We've never had that luxury. We've always had to produce for ourselves. We've always had to create new ways of distributing resources because they've always been scarce. That's in our history. So I don't want to encourage us to like live in a tree, because I don't believe in that either. And some people be like, let's just quit the whole thing. And I'm like, cool. But, you know, right? But I do believe that people who have deep relationship to each other, who share their dreams together, can figure out a path on how to get there. I do believe that. And I see a lot of y'all doing that, right? Building deeper bonds between people so that we can trust each other enough to say, this is what I really, really long for. Yeah?
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Hey.
Hi, how are you today?
I'm fantastic. How are
my
you?
Name is, sorry. My name is Jade, and I'm representing Teen Empowerment.
Yay! Y'all real deep. How many teen empowerment people in the room? Yes, represent.
I just wanted to, I took a lot of notes while you were talking.
Yeah.
Like a bunch of notes.
You want mine?
Sorry. I just wanted to thank you for dedicating your time and showing your true consistency and love to your cause, acknowledging the importance of African American lives. And before I ask you my question, I just wanted to state a few facts and statements before I ask you my question. And I was saying for thousands of years that African Americans were mistreated and abused and stripped of their rights. For the people who don't appreciate and acknowledge the presence of African Americans should take a minute to evaluate how we originated in this country. But like many others, such as Native Americans who originated in America, they were too stripped of their rights, dignity, pride, and identity.
And land.
Referring to times in the 1800s, such as the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, when all men were declared free. We have never been free. When I say we, I mean we as in African Americans, because I refuse to see this as one nation that has never been fully qualified, who has never fully qualified rights of those who lay their lives down for this country. We are a free nation today as of 2015, but as many of us, we are still mentally enslaved, way beyond our knowledge. So my only question is just how much more do we have to sacrifice? How many African Americans have to die because of police brutality? How many other individuals will be on trial for their own deaths? How many more jobs and school will we be turned down from? How many more protests and riots do we have to put up with nationwide before enough is enough until we are really declared free? How much more? And my question was, how do we really become a qualified in a world where, referring back to what the previous questioner has asked you, the government has not set up for us to succeed in this world. I see many groups like such as Teen Empowerment, and I'm sure many others that are here today have set out to, you know, do community activists, have gone to school, completed high school rates are going up. But it seems to be that many of us are not getting accepted into colleges. Many of us are being killed. Many of us are not being treated equally. And positions to people who do not have the same color as them are being given. So I just wanted to know, how do we make ourselves qualified?
You know, if I knew the answer to that, we'd be free.
Yes.
But I think it starts with what you're doing. I really want to just continue to say that over and over again, because there isn't a secret sauce. The only secret is you can't stand on the sidelines. That's it. You have to be in it. You got to throw down from wherever you are with whatever you can. Seriously. I don't think I can say that enough, because I think... we all want the roadmap. I want to make the roadmap. I don't know what it is. I don't have the secret sauce. I don't know the answer to how we get free. All I know is we don't get there by being like, well, I'm just going to wait till... I'm going to wait till y'all get a little further, and then I'm going to come on through, you know?
Yes.
What y'all are doing is a great start.
Thank you.
You can fight to change education in this country. You can fight privatization of our education system. You can fight to make sure that institutions like this are for you. There's something, too, about cultivating your faith. This world is hard. This world is hard. On our good days, we get up and we put on our masks and we smile and I'm good, I got this. But it's hard. So there has to be something bigger that you believe in. I'm not necessarily talking about religion, but faith. You have to be able to see what you want. Be able to connect with that every single day. Even if it's not directly in front of you, imagine that it is. That's all I got.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I just want to thank you again and ask you for a hug.
Thank you.
Can I have a hug? And thank you for you dedicating your time again.
Thank you for being here.
A hug.
I got you. Come on. Thank you. What's your name?
My name is Tierra Council. I'm a sophomore, and I go to Boston Prep. Boston Prep.
Yay!
and I just wanted to personally ask you about your thoughts about colorism within our own black race, and is there a way to cure ourselves from this mindset of believing that one skin color is superior than the other? Because I know a lot on social media, we have this thoughts of, like, light skin is better than dark skin, when in reality, they all see us as one race, and that we shouldn't have this division within our own race. We should come together. So what is your thoughts about that? And is there a cure from freeing ourselves from this super old mentality of believing that one skin color is superior than the other?
Is there a cure? Maybe. Huh? Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, here's the thing. So we talked about this earlier, that, you know, I'm gonna give you the same response that I give when folks are like, well, if you really care about black lives, or do you care about black people killing black people? Totally. There's nobody that cares more about black people killing black people than black people.
Right.
But I wanna say the same thing, because I think it's important, which is, you know, we have learned, those of us that have zero power, to find ways to exercise just a little bit of power over someone else. Just a little bit of power. To feel powerful. I bet you, if we had actual power, power that wasn't about domination over, we could shift that. What's underneath this light skin, dark skin thing?
I think a lot. I don't know. I mean, some could say self-hatred for one's race, but then at the same time, maybe it's just thinking that this whole, like, slavery mentality, where they had the, you know, the indoor slaves, and because of they were lighter, they were kind of better than the people, the darker people who were picking cotton. And I guess it's like whole mentality of, oh, I'm in the house, so I'm better than you. But, I mean, you could say that sparks it, but you could also say social media, so it's multiple answers. But my real question was, how did we enable this level or platform of being socially conscious and socially aware? Because we can read 1,000 books, but not everyone is really gonna take that in. There's only a few people who really wanna understand and conquer what we have to face as a black community. So how can we reach out to everyone who may not always read a book or already have this, like, socially aware, socially conscious, like, state of mind within them, but to just change our race. Not change our race, like, you know what I mean, but just change our thoughts and as a union fight back and not just have these Uncle Ruckuses.
Let me push you for a second. Let's reframe that. Because yeah. We do a lot of this esoteric stuff, like how can we, right? And it's like there's no answer to those questions.
Yeah.
The real question is, what are you doing to shift that for yourself, for your community? How are you supporting that in other people?
I think pride in one's race and culture. I think if you show people that you're pride, you have pride in your race, people think, you know, that people will bring that into them, like, wow, this one is really embracing their black culture, and maybe I should learn to embrace my natural hair, maybe I should learn to embrace my skin color, and from there, they can start something. But
you answered your own question.
I guess I did. I just wanted to know your thoughts, but you reflected on me, so.
You answered your own question.
Yeah.
So. Yeah? Mm-hmm. I mean, this question of how can we, so there's the question of how can I, how do I, mm-hmm. right? And I work on myself every single day.
Yeah.
I acknowledge that I have weaknesses. I have prejudices. I try to think about where do those come from? How does that serve me? What do I get out of that? What impact does it have on other people? I try to listen.
Yeah.
I try to live that every day. I don't preach at people. I can't tell people what to do. All I can do is spark your imagination.
Yeah, definitely.
And then together, if we're brave enough, we can walk towards that.
Right. Thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you again, Ms. Garza, for an inspirational evening. To close us out, please help me welcome Kumba to the stage. Black music is a manifestation of the Black spirit. It speaks to our every emotion. It reminds us of our past situation in this country, makes us mindful of our present, and gives us hope and guidance for our future. So today, 45 years after its inception, Kuumba continues to celebrate the beauty of Black lives, Black creativity, and Black spirituality in all of its forms. To close out this evening, we have a few selections for you all. The first is Lift Every Voice and Sing, also known as the Black National Anthem, and Kosi Sikelele Africa, which is a song of resistance coming out of South Africa and was later incorporated into the South African National Anthem. So please feel free to join in, but we'd like to ask you to stand because it is an anthem. Thank you.
Ring with the harmony.
You can feel free to have a seat.
Thank you.
Trials, oh yes, we've come a long way. Now there was a time when they thought we weren't human, and then we grew to be 3/5 of a man. And now I'm standing here today, 'cause somebody made a way. Now it's my turn to lend a helping hand. Now I don't know what got them up each morning, and I don't know how they made it through the day, but they found the strength to carry on, though the road was rough and long, and that struggle taught us how to fight and pray. We've come a long way, yes, we've come a long way. Help me sing. trials. Oh, yes, we have. We've been in the valley all, but we shall fear no evil. We've come a long way.
Hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while. Just a little while longer. Hold on. Just a little while longer. Hold on. Just a little while longer. Pray on just a little while longer. Pray on just a little while longer. You need to pray on just a little while, just a little while, just a little while. 'Cause everything will be all right. Oh, I tell you, everything will be all right. You need to fight on, you need to fight on, you need to fight on just a little while longer. Fight on just a little while, just a little while longer. You need to fight on, you need to fight on just a little while, just a little while. 'Cause everything will be all right. I tell you, everything will be all right. Oh, you know, you got to sing on. You know, you got to sing on. You need to sing on, although the road may be hard, 'cause everything everything will be all right. Ooh, I tell you everything, everything, oh, will be all right. Ooh, you gotta hold on, oh, hold on, oh, you gotta hold on, hold on, hold on just a little while longer. Tell you everything. Oh, I tell you everything. I tell you everything. Ooh, oh, everything will be all right. Oh, I tell you everything. Though the hit may be hard. Oh, oh, and the pain is so deep. Oh, I tell you everything will be. Just a little while, I tell you, hold on. Just a little while, though the road may be long, though it may be so long, you got to hold.